Welcome to this webinar on software security. My name is Frank Pieses. I'm a professor at the KU Leuven University in Belgium, and it's my pleasure to introduce you to the software security knowledge area of the cybersecurity body of knowledge. So what is software security? A kind of a general definition could be that this field studies the problem of maintaining good properties of software systems in the presence of intelligent adversaries trying to break these properties. So the intelligent is important here. In security and also in software security, we assume that the attacker, the adversary, is a strategic intelligent entity who understands the system under attack and who tries to find ways of breaking the properties that the defenders are trying to maintain. So in order to rigorously study any security problem, and hence also a software security problem, you typically need three ingredients. You need a system model that's a rigorous description of the system that you are trying to secure. That is important because often in attack scenarios, attackers will drive the system into corner cases, into states that may not be reached very often, into behavior that you may not even know that the system has. So understanding all aspects of the system deeply is an important precondition to studying the security of the system. So we capture that in a system model. A next ingredient is the security objective. So the notion of security in itself is not very informative. What is a secure system? We have to define that. We have to specify that. And that's specified in a security objective. So for example, there you would specify things like, what are these good properties that we want to maintain? Or alternatively, what are the bad things that we want to prevent? What kind of things should never happen to the system? Finally, a third important ingredient is the attacker model. In the attacker model, we make assumptions about what an attacker can and cannot do. If an attacker can do anything, if an attacker can read and flip any bit in any computer system across the world, there's no way to get any notion of security. So we have to make some assumptions on what an attacker can do and cannot do. And based on these assumptions, we can then come up with security mechanisms that may help us achieve our security objectives. Now, in software security, in practice, this security objective is often not very explicit. For many software systems, we don't even have precise functionality specifications, let alone precise security objectives. We may have vague objectives, like we want to keep customer data confidential, but we don't have sufficiently precise security objectives to study the security of the system. So in practice, very often, software security is about avoiding specific bugs, specific classes of bugs that can lead to significant disruption of the software, such significant disruption that it will likely break any security objective you might have, even if that objective is implicit. So these bugs often enable attack techniques that give an intelligent adversary so much power that it's clear that you want to avoid them. An evidence for the importance of these kinds of implementation vulnerabilities, as they are called, is the fact that since a couple of years, new important such vulnerabilities that are found are kind of being marketed. They get a logo, they get a fancy name, they get a popularizing website to raise awareness about these implementation vulnerabilities. So as an example on the slide, you see these two logos here refer to Heartbleed and Cloudbleed, and these were two examples of vulnerabilities in the class of memory management vulnerabilities that we will zoom into in more detail later in this presentation. And for example, the fourth one here, a very recent one, refers to Spectre, a class of vulnerabilities and attacks that exploit speculative execution in modern processors. And we'll also come back to that vulnerability in a bit more detail later in this presentation. So this is really what the software security knowledge area is about, these implementation vulnerabilities. So the document, the software security knowledge area document, discusses a number of important categories of these vulnerabilities and also discusses the techniques to prevent, detect, or mitigate them. Now, in this seminar, I will not cover the entire content of the document. What I will do is I will focus on explaining three categories of vulnerabilities: memory management vulnerabilities, structured output generation vulnerabilities, and side channel vulnerabilities. The software security document, in addition, discusses a number of other categories of vulnerabilities and also discusses an overview of the countermeasures for prevention, detection, and mitigation. And I encourage you very much to dive into the document after this seminar to learn more about prevention, detection, and mitigation. So we're going to talk about classes of implementation vulnerabilities. So how do we make that classification? Well, that's hard. So remember my definition of an implementation vulnerability of a couple of slides back. An implementation vulnerability is a bug, a defect in software code that enables a specific attack technique, an attack technique that's so bad that it can lead to significant disruption of the software. Right? And there are many of these. Evidence for that is, for example, the CVE list, the Common Vulnerabilities and Exposures. This is a list of unique identifiers for software vulnerabilities in widely used software maintained by an organization in the United States. And that list has around 100,000 vulnerabilities as we speak. So it's an impressive number. And they are very varied. You have buffer overflow, SQL injection, cross-site scripting. You see all the names on the slide here. I don't want to go into detail into all of them. I just show you this list to show that there is quite a bit of variation in the nature of these vulnerabilities. So there is currently no widely accepted classification or taxonomy that is complete and orthogonal. So what we did in the software security knowledge area document is identify a number of classes that clearly are important, but without any claim of a complete classification or an orthogonal classification. And what we'll do in this presentation is discuss three of these classes in detail. So the first class that I want to zoom into are memory management vulnerabilities. They are known under a number of different names too. So some people refer to these as buffer overflows, memory safety vulnerabilities, memory errors. There is no generally agreed upon terminology. What they are about is bugs in C-like languages. So languages like C and C++ offer mutable state. You can have variables that you can assign to. You can allocate mutable state, you can deallocate it, and you can access it in a number of different ways. So you can declare local and global variables and assign to them, for example. You can use malloc and free in C, or you can use the new operator in C++ to dynamically allocate memory. And you can allocate all the memory that you allocate either by using variable names or by accessing that memory through pointers or through array indexing. So these operations, this variety of memory management and access operations, should be used correctly. If you use these operations to allocate and access memory in incorrect ways, your program is buggy. It has errors. For example, if you access an array with an index that is outside of the bounds of an array, that's clearly an error. If you access memory after you have freed it, after you have deallocated it, that's also clearly an error. If you allocate memory and then free it and then free it again, so-called double free, that's also an example of an error. So for performance purposes, compilers of C-like languages do not detect these buggy memory accesses. So the compiler does not detect them statically, and it also does not eject code to detect these errors at runtime. Instead, what the C language specification says is that if your program encounters one of these errors, the behavior of the program becomes undefined. And that's actually what makes these errors, these bugs, so dangerous. Because undefined means, in reality, implementation defined. So depending on how the C compiler, the underlying operating system, processor, and so forth work, something will happen. And an intelligent adversary, an attacker, can try to figure out what will happen if it triggers this bug and can try to steer that behavior into a dangerous direction, into a direction that's good for the attacker, but that breaks some of the good properties of the software under attack. OK. Okay, so that's why we call these bugs vulnerabilities, and they are part of a general class called memory management vulnerabilities. So in order to explain why this is dangerous and how these attacks work, I have to, as I discussed in the introduction, give you a system model. So I have to explain a little bit how C programs are executed at runtime. Now, clearly, the details of this vary widely with the underlying platform. What processor do you have? What operating system do you have? And with the compiler that you are using. Now, fortunately, the general structure of these processors, operating systems, and compilers is sufficiently close that if you understand how a memory management vulnerability is abused on one system, you generally can port that understanding to different systems. So what I'll do in this webinar is give kind of a general abstract explanation on how a C program is executed and use that to explain why these memory management vulnerabilities, these memory management bugs are so dangerous. And I hope that then with that abstract understanding, you can instantiate that knowledge to any specific system that you might be interested in. So how do C programs get compiled and executed? So compilation in C is modular. So C program consists of a number of global variables and functions, and each of these functions is compiled separately to machine code, and all that machine code is stored in the memory space of the machine code program. So you can think of this picture here as, for example, the virtual memory address space of a process that will run a compiled C program. Part of the memory space of that process will be used to store the code, the compiled code of the C program. That's the code section at the bottom here. At runtime, the global control flow through the program will be tracked by what is called a call stack. So there will be a stack-like data structure in memory called the call stack that will have a stack record or an activation record for every function invocation that is active in the program. So when the main function is invoked, a stack record from main is created, and when main calls a function F, a new stack record for F is created, and when F calls G, a stack record for G is created, and so forth. And when a function returns, for example, when G returns, the corresponding stack record will be popped off the stack. So this call stack is used to track the global control flow throughout the program. So with this understanding, we can now understand how variables, how mutable state is represented in memory at runtime. Local variables will be allocated in this call stack. Why? Because a local variable exists for the duration of the invocation of a function. And that's exactly also how long a stack record for that function invocation exists. So stack records are the logical place to store local variables. Global variables that have to live for the entire lifetime of a program are stored in what is called the data section in memory. So the compiler knows how many global variables there are and how big they are and allocates a section in memory to store these variables. And then finally, dynamic allocation, so things like malloc free and new, are handled by allocating a big area of memory called the heap and having that managed by a memory management library that essentially will implement functionality for malloc and free. Malloc will look for a chunk of memory that is currently free and return a pointer to it to the program, and free will mark that memory as available again to be reused in future invocations of malloc. Finally, what we need to know in order to understand attacks is how pointers and arrays are represented at runtime in C. So pointers are just represented as integer addresses into this memory space. So a pointer is just an integer address of a cell in memory. By using that representation, pointer arithmetic becomes very simple. It's just integer addition. C also represents arrays as just pointers to the first element of the array. And as a consequence, indexing into an array is also just integer addition. It's similar to pointer arithmetic. That is what we need to understand about compilation and execution of C programs to understand attacks. But before we can talk about attacks, we have to, of course, make explicit our attacker model. So what do we assume that the attacker can and cannot do? So for memory management vulnerabilities, the typical attacker model is that the attacker interacts with the program by giving the program input and by looking at the output that the program generates. So we will also assume that the attacker understands the system under attack, so he knows the source code of the program, and he knows and understands the system software stack of the victim. So he knows how the program is compiled, on what operating system it's running, on what processor it's executing, and so forth. Okay, so that's the power of the attacker. So what can such an attacker do? Well, if the program, the victim program, the program that the attacker is interacting with, has one of these memory management vulnerabilities, the attacker can actually do very powerful things. And I just want to show two examples of things that can go wrong. The first one is a memory corruption attack. So in the code you see here, it's toy code that's made as small as possible to illustrate the essence of the problem. We see that there is a variable called isAdmin. And the assumption is that this variable if this is different from zero, the program gets more functionality. There are things you can do that only an administrator can do, and these will only be enabled if the isAdmin variable is different from zero. In this toy program, the only thing that happens is the program prints out you are administrator. But you can imagine that this is a model for more power that you get as an administrator. Also, the program has allocated a buffer, an array of 10 characters, through which it will receive input from the user of the program. This gets function here is a C function that will read characters from standard input until a new line is encountered and will store these characters in the buffer. Now, at this point, you can see that this program has a memory management vulnerability because gets will read characters from standard input until a new line is encountered and will store them in buffer. But it doesn't check, gets doesn't check whether it goes out of bounds of the buffer while storing characters. So what will happen at runtime is, as the attacker is typing characters, they will be stored in the buffer here. Both this local variable and this local array will be, as we discussed, allocated in an activation record on the stack. So in memory, they are, for example, here. Now, if the attacker is typing characters into this buffer, the buffer will slowly fill up. And since gets does not check whether it passes the bounds of the buffer, in other words, it has a memory management vulnerability, when the attacker keeps typing more than 10 characters, it will start overflowing into this memory area here. And one of the consequences of that is that the contents of the isAdmin variable will change. In other words, at that point, the program will actually get these administrator privileges. So this is an example of what is called a data-only attack, where a memory management vulnerability is used to unexpectedly change the values of other variables in the program. But I think you can see that this power to change cells in memory that actually are not supposed to be changed could also be abused for many other things. There's a wide range of attacks known that the attacker can do if he has this power of memory corruption. He might be able to change the code, for example. That's called a code corruption attack. Or he might be able to change the control flow in the program, and these are called code injection attacks, and you have direct and indirect code injection attacks. And the document on the software security knowledge area provides a bit more background on these. Okay, so that's a memory corruption attack. You don't even have to change memory to do dangerous things. So another kind of thing you can do is memory disclosure. And here is, again, a very simple example that shows what can go wrong. So here is the code of a very simple C program again. This time it uses dynamic allocation, so it allocates state on the heap. It will allocate a buffer containing one integer that we assume to be a secret of the program. For example, it could be a cryptographic key, but in our simple example, it will just contain the number 999. So that will be allocated somewhere on the heap. So on the slide you see here, the secret pointer to a cell allocated on the heap that contains the secret value. The program also at some other place allocates a data buffer containing 10 integers. And again, you see it allocated on the heap in the picture next to the code. We'll assume that this data buffer contains public data that users of the program can query. And actually, that's what the main part of this program does. It reads an integer from standard input, uses that as an index into the data array, and outputs the corresponding entry in the data array. So essentially, the user of the program can query what is in data. Right? But of course, again, you see that this program has a very stupid memory management vulnerability. It doesn't check the bounds of the integer that is being read from standard input and just uses it as an index in data. As a consequence, a malicious user of the program, an attacker, might enter integers that are way too big, bigger than 10 in this case, and these would actually index into memory above the place where the data buffer is allocated. Remember that array indexing is just like pointer arithmetic, so by using big integers, essentially what the user of the program can do is inspect all cells of memory above the data buffer. In particular, one of the things that the attacker can do is get to know the secret that was supposed not to leak. This is called a memory disclosure attack, or a memory leak, or a memory read vulnerability, a buffer overread vulnerability. And this is similar to what the Heartbleed vulnerability that I mentioned in the introduction of this presentation actually did. So by doing a buffer overread similar to this, an attacker could actually read cryptographic keys from a service memory. So that concludes my discussion of the first class of vulnerabilities, memory management vulnerabilities. And we move on to the second class of vulnerabilities, structured output generation vulnerabilities. Again, also these vulnerabilities are known under a number of different names. Another common name for them is injection vulnerabilities. So what are these about? Well, programs often construct structured output that will be consumed by some other program. For example, a web application might construct SQL queries that are then sent to a database. If a program does that kind of structured output generation using string concatenation, so it will essentially create a program like a SQL query for another to be executed by another program, for example, the database, by putting that program together concatenating strings, this is very error prone. In particular, when some of the strings that are used to concatenate the structured output can be chosen by an attacker, it's very likely that the attacker can actually change the intended structure of the output. Okay? That's the essence of a structured output generation vulnerability. To explain it in more detail, I will again first look at a system model and attacker model. So for structured output generation vulnerabilities, the system model is we have a vulnerable program that has two communication channels. It has a communication channel with the user of the program, where a user can provide input and possibly read output from the program. And the program will use some of these inputs to communicate with another program. So it will create output to be sent to this other program, possibly based on the input received from the user communication channel. So the attacker model here is, the power that we assume the attacker has is, again, the attacker will understand the entire system. So he will know how the vulnerable program is creating structured output, and he will understand how that structured output will be used by the other program that the structured output is sent to. In addition, we assume that the attacker can interact with the vulnerable program over this user communication channel. In other words, the attacker can determine the input that will be used to create the structured output sent to the other program. So let's look at an example to clarify this. So here is an example of what is called a SQL injection attack. And so we see here an instantiation of the system model where the victim program is web application code. And this web application code will talk to a database, will send SQL queries to a database in order to implement any kind of persistent storage that it needs. The queries sent to that database might depend on information sent to the web application by users of the web application to their browsers. For example, the browser might have a form in which a user can type in a number of strings, press the submit button, and that these strings will go to the web application code that may then use them to implement the logic of the web application, possibly relying on help from a database. In this example, we will assume that the web application code will construct a SQL query using code as shown on the slide here. So essentially, it will create a select query where part of the select query, in particular this name and password here, will be strings coming from the user. They might have been entered to a web form by the user and have been sent to the web application and are then used to construct this SQL query. So in the normal case, in the non-malicious case, we can see that this works great. If the user enters a username of Anne and a password of, for example, XX, then the following SQL query will be generated, the query that you see here on the slide. And the semantics of this query is that it will look for a row in the user's table that has a name Anne and a password XX. And this might, for example, be used to determine whether a user by that name and password is known to the system and, for example, is allowed to log in and proceed to access the system. Now, how can an attacker abuse the fact that this SQL query is created by essentially pasting together strings, some in the program code and some coming from the attacker? Well, here's an example of how an attacker could abuse that. If the attacker picks the name to be of this form, the form you see here on the slide, he will succeed in changing the semantics of the generated query. So the essential trick that the attacker is doing here is he's using a double quote in the input, in the name input, to close this double quote here, and he's then using a comment character, a SQL comment character, the dash dash here, to throw away the rest of the query. So with on this input, this code would generate the following query for the database. And we see indeed that the quote entered by the attacker closes this quote, and then the dash dash here comments out the remainder of the generated query. So in practice, what will go to the database is this query. The commented part is thrown out, is not considered by the database. And clearly, this has a completely different semantics. This selects a row from the user's table where just the name is Anne. So now you can log into the system by just providing a correct name and without knowing the actual password, something that is clearly a security vulnerability. So these structured output generation vulnerabilities may seem simple at first, but unfortunately, there are several factors that contribute to the difficulty of avoiding them in real-world code. So two examples of these complications are the structured output that the program generates can be in a language that has sublanguages with, again, a completely different syntactic structure. The prototypical example of this case is HTML. So HTML is a widely used language, and there are many programs that generate HTML. For example, web servers do so. And HTML has sublanguages that look different than HTML. So HTML has sublanguages, JavaScript, cascading style sheets, scalable vector graphics, and so forth. So given such a complex structured output, it's hard to make sure that indeed the generated output will always comply with the intended structure that the programmer had in mind. A second complication that arises is that the structured output generation can happen in a number of phases. So instead of taking the input and immediately generating the structured output, a program might first store the input, later read it back, and then generate the structured output. And there might actually be multiple of these phases in between. So we call vulnerabilities that happen because of these intermediate phases, stored injection vulnerabilities, or if there are multiple phases, higher order injection vulnerabilities. And again, this complicates finding these vulnerabilities in code and avoiding them while you're developing the system. So as a third class of vulnerabilities, I want to look at side channel vulnerabilities. So while I think it's fair to say that the first two classes, memory management vulnerabilities and structured output generation vulnerabilities, are very important in practice and have historically been the most important classes of vulnerabilities for many years. Memory management vulnerabilities are decades old. Side channel vulnerabilities are a bit the up-and-coming class of vulnerabilities. So many of the recent vulnerabilities and new vulnerabilities that are found and that have a substantial impact are in this class of side channel vulnerabilities, and hence I wanted to spend some time on this class too in this seminar. So what are they? So the term side channel is used to refer to an information channel, so something that can leak information about the execution of a program through effects that were never intended to be used for communication. For example, you may learn something about the data in the program by measuring how much time it takes to execute the program. Or you might measure how much power the program consumes during execution, and by measuring that, learn something about what the program is doing. Or the CPU executing the program might have electromagnetic radiation emanating from it, and the kind of electromagnetic radiation that's coming out might tell you something about what the CPU is doing. So these classic side channels typically require physical access to the system. If you want to measure whether there's electromagnetic radiation coming from a system, you have to be close to the system. You have to have physical access to the system. Now, software-based side channels are side channels that can be read by software running on the same system as the program under attack. So a software-based side channel is essentially a side channel that you can read without being physically present next to the system that's executing the victim program. So a very recent and important class of such software-based side channels exploit the effects of processor implementations. And we call these software-based microarchitectural side channels. And it's this class of side channels that I want to zoom in as the third example class in this seminar. So again, let me start with a system model. So in this, for this class of vulnerabilities, we care about systems that run programs for multiple stakeholders. So because we need at least two programs running on the system, one victim program and one attacker program. The attacker will use software running on the same system as the victim to learn to read information from side channels, essentially. So as a system model, we have a shared platform, a platform that runs code from multiple stakeholders. And almost all systems are like that these days. Cloud systems run code from multiple stakeholders. Your phone runs code from multiple stakeholders. A web page runs JavaScript from multiple stakeholders, and so forth and so forth. Now, if a system has the intention of running programs from multiple stakeholders, it usually will also have isolation mechanisms to isolate these programs from one another. So there are many of these isolation mechanisms. I will just focus on process-based isolation in this seminar, but virtual machines is another example. Enclaves are another example, and you also have software-defined isolation mechanisms. But let's focus on processes. So a classic operating system is designed to run code from multiple stakeholders and to limit the interference between code from one stakeholder and code from another stakeholder by running that code in different processes, where these different processes essentially get their own virtual memory address space, and so by default cannot interfere with one another. Of course, the platform usually will also support some kind of communication between these programs, so there are mechanisms to explicitly allow communication. For example, a process might open a socket to accept communication with another process. Or two processes might agree to share a specific section of their memory so that they can communicate through shared memory. Okay, so that's the system model, a shared platform that runs code from multiple stakeholders that are isolated from each other but may have mechanisms to communicate with each other. So what is the attacker model here? So for side channel vulnerabilities, for software-based side channel vulnerabilities, we'll assume that the attacker can run code on the same platform where victim code is running. So here we see our system model again, a shared platform. Where we now see that some program is running, and we assume that, for example, this program may have some secrets that it wants to keep. But on the same platform, code from other stakeholders is running, and we assume in the attacker model that the attacker controls at least one of these other programs on the platform. And now the objective of the attacker will be to learn about the secrets of this victim program, more than what, of course, the victim program communicates through intended communication interfaces. If a program shares data over a socket, then clearly that's not a problem. What we care about is secrets that the program does not want to share with others, so does not send out over intended communication interfaces. We want to make sure that the attacker cannot learn that. And the attacker's objective is exactly to learn these secrets. Now, for micro-architectural side channel attacks, what the attacker will use is so-called shared micro-architectural resources. So let me briefly explain what these are. If we think of a processor, a CPU, or a computer system in general, part of the state of that computer system will be observable by software. We call that the architectural state. And that typically will include things like the memory and the contents of the registers of the processor. That's the architectural state, and it can be observed and manipulated by software running on the processor. Now, processors will have additional state in their implementation, for instance, to possibly enhance the performance of the processor. And we call that additional state that's not directly observable by software micro-architectural state. And a typical example would be something like a cache. A cache is a smaller, faster memory that the processor can use to keep memory cells that are frequently being accessed so that the execution of the program can proceed faster. The intention is that the presence of a cache speeds up things, but apart from that, is invisible to software. So the cache is transparent. The behavior of the software should not change because of the presence of the cache. Only the speed of execution should improve thanks to this addition of a cache. Now, what we'll see is that these micro-architectural attacks show that this micro-architectural state is maybe not as invisible as we thought it was. And I'm again going to explain that by means of an example. I'm first going to explain a cache-based side channel attack, and then I'm going to build on that to make a speculative execution side channel attack, which is this novel class of attacks that is only a year old and that has a significant impact on how we think about software security these days. So let's first look at the side channel attack. Side channel attacks have been known for a while. I'm going to again try to explain how they work by using the simplest example I could think of. So we see here the system model again. We have a shared platform with victim code and attacker code. We're going to assume that the victim has some secrets that it wants to keep. Again, the simplest I can think of is one single secret Boolean. The value of this Boolean secret here is something that the victim program intends to keep secret, so it will not send this out over intended communication interfaces. In fact, we can assume for this example that there are no intended communication interfaces, so attacker program and victim program really run in isolated processes on the shared platform. But we will assume that some of the micro-architectural resources are shared among the various programs being executed on the platform. In particular, we will assume for this example that there is a shared cache between the attacker program and the victim program. So the CPU has a cache that it shares among the different programs running on top of the CPU. And again, for simplicity's purposes, I'm taking the simplest kind of cache, which is a direct mapped cache. So what that means is, a cache is always smaller than main memory, of course. So that means memory cells will compete for entries in the cache. That also means that sometimes when a memory cell is moved to the cache, some other memory cell has to be evicted. In a direct mapped cache, the rules are very simple. Each memory cell can only go into one specific entry in the cache. And this is indicated by means of the colors on this figure. So the blue memory cells will go into this cache entry. The green ones will go into this cache entry and so forth. So that also means that if at some point this memory cell is in the cache and the processor now wants to bring this memory cell in, then this one will have to be evicted. Right? Okay, so that's a direct mapped cache. So let's now, as a final assumption, assume that the victim program has code that performs secret-dependent memory accesses. Right? So what that means is the code will compute on the secret, in this case the secret Boolean, and then depending on whether the secret is true or false, it will access different parts of memory. In the simple example here, if the secret is true, it will load from address 4. If the secret is false, it will load from address 5. Okay. With all these assumptions, we can now explain how an attacker can get to know the secret using this cache-based side channel attack. So what the attacker will do is, he knows that the victim will either load address 4 or load address 5 based on the secret. He knows that these addresses 4 and 5 go to these two cache lines, to these two entries in the cache. So the first thing the attacker will do is he will make sure that these cache cells are occupied by cells that belong to the attacker. Since the cache is shared between victim and attacker, it's possible for the attacker to find memory cells that belong to him that map to the same cache entries as these addresses 4 and 5 that the victim might access later. And so in the preparation, the attacker will make sure that his cells are in the cache. Then the attacker waits until the victim runs. So for example, the attacker is idle, the scheduler at some point schedules the victim, and now the victim will execute this code that does secret-dependent memory accesses. So in particular, if the secret is true, the victim will load address 4. Address 4 will go to the cache, and as a consequence, address 0 of the attacker will be evicted from the cache. And that is, of course, something that the attacker can now learn or measure when he gets control again, perhaps because the scheduler after a while gives the control back to the attacker program. What the attacker can now do is he can measure how long it takes for him to read address 0 and to read address 1. In the state of the cache that we see here, reading address 1 will be fast because it's still in the cache. Reading address 0 will be slower because it has to be fetched from main memory. So the attacker learns that his address 0 was evicted. So he learns that address 4 was loaded. So he learns that the secret was actually true. So this is the simplest example of a cache-based side channel attack that I could come up with, and I hope it explains to you the essence of this kind of side channel. Now, side channels have been known for a while, and they are important, but they're not that dangerous. They're important mainly in really security-critical software. So, for example, if you're implementing cryptography, then leaking a few bits of the keys is already dangerous. So cryptographic code will typically have to be hardened against these kinds of attacks. And for example, programmers of cryptographic algorithms may try to use what is called constant time code. So they will try to avoid any kind of secret-dependent memory accesses in their code. But for general purpose applications, leakage through cache-based side channels is not always an important issue. And an important factor of that is that the attacker can learn some things, but he can't control what he will learn. So what will leak depends on the code of the victim, and that's something that the attacker cannot choose, cannot control. So there will be some leakage. The attacker will learn some things, but in many cases, this will not be useful enough to the attacker to make this attack valuable in practice. This changed in 2018 with the advent of transient execution attacks. So transient execution attacks essentially are a way to amplify the impact of existing side channels like the cache-based side channel that I just explained, because they offer a way to give the attacker control over the sending side of the channel. So using these transient execution attacks that I'll explain over the next slide, an attacker will be able to choose what a victim program will send over this side channel, and that, of course, amplifies the impact of the attack tremendously. Now, the key observations, and I'll go in more detail on the next slides, but the key observations of how a transient execution attack works are as follows. So first, I will explain you that processors these days are pipelined and they sometimes execute instructions speculatively, ahead of time, before they know for certain that the result of these instructions will be necessary. Now, the processor will be careful and make sure that if it turns out that these speculatively executed instructions are not necessary, the processor will make sure that no architectural effects will be visible. So the software visible part of the state of the processor will not be impacted. However, if speculative execution happens and turns out not to be necessary, we call that transient execution. So execution happens and is then rolled back to some extent. That transient execution does impact the microarchitectural state. So it can impact, for example, what will go into the cache and what not. And since what is present in the cache is essentially the mechanism of communication of the cache-based side channel that we just discussed, the fact that these transiently executed instructions can impact the cache means that they can send on the cache-based side channel that we just discussed. And the final point, the thing that really puts a nail in the coffin, essentially, is that we will see that an attacker can actually influence what instructions will be executed transiently by the victim program. And so these two things together will mean that the attacker can choose what gets sent on the microarchitectural side channel, on the cache-based side channel. Okay, let me go into these points in a bit more detail. So first, pipelining and speculative execution. So all major processors today support pipelining and speculative execution. So what is pipelining? Well, with pipelining, an instruction is split into a number of phases. For example, on the example here, we have an instruction fetch phase, an instruction decode phase, an execute phase, a memory access phase, and a write back phase. Why do we do that? Why do we split instructions into phases? Well, because now we can start doing these different phases in parallel. So we might fetch the first instruction, and while we are decoding the first instruction, we already fetch the second. While we're executing the first instruction, we decode the second, and we fetch the third, and so forth. And in this, you can see that in the steady state, when the pipeline is completely full, we will actually be executing five instructions in parallel, in the best case leading to a fivefold increase in the performance of the program. So that's why pipelining is so useful. Now, this works great if we know what the instructions are that we have to execute next. If we have straight line code, then while we are decoding one instruction, we know that the instruction to fetch is the next one. But of course, code has branches. If we have an if-then-else branch, if the code can go two ways, essentially, then we do not know what the next instruction to fetch for the pipeline is. We will only know once we have evaluated the branch condition whether we should go to the then or the else part of a branch. So in order to keep the pipeline full anyway, what processors will do is they will speculate. They will guess, they will predict whether the then or the else branch will be taken, and they will keep feeding the pipeline with instructions according to this prediction. If it turns out the prediction was correct, the pipeline remains full and the processor keeps executing at full speed. If it turns out the prediction was incorrect, then part of this the instructions that are currently in the pipeline being executed will have to be undone, will have to be rolled back. And that is what we call transient execution. If some instructions get executed because the processor predicts they might be necessary, but it then turns out the prediction was wrong and the architectural effects of these instructions are rolled back, but possibly microarchitectural effects, like effects on the cache, remain. Right? So let's see how that can be used by an attacker to amplify the cache-based side channel attack. So here again, we see a single platform with a direct mapped cache that's running attacker code in attacker memory and victim code with corresponding victim memory. Right? Again, we assume that the cache is shared between attacker and victim. So that means for cells in victim memory, the attacker can find cells in his own memory that compete for the same cache lines. Now let's first look at the victim code. Again, I created the smallest possible example to illustrate the essence of the problem. So the example may seem a bit contrived, but it's made as small as possible to show what could go wrong. So in this case, the victim code has an intended communication mechanism. It offers a process method, for example, by listening on a socket. It accepts integers from a socket and processes them using this particular function. And what the function does is it performs a bounce check and then a double array dereference. Let's now assume that this first array, the pub array here, is allocated in memory here. And let's assume that this pub array does not contain any secrets. It may contain publicly known constants, for example, that we don't care that leak. We also assume that somewhere else in memory, there may be secrets. These secrets are not used by the code here. They might be used by other functions of the victim. For example, we assume on this picture here that there's a secret variable currently containing the value 3 somewhere in memory. For simplicity, we assume it to be next to the pub array, but it might be anywhere else in memory. That's not that important. And finally, we assume that the array B here, that the attacker has found in his own memory an array that has competing that is competing for the cache with the array B used here by the victim code. Okay. Under these assumptions, the attacker will now be able to learn the secret, even though the victim code never even accesses it. Right. So if you look at the code of the victim here that will be executed, it never even touches this secret variable here. So you would expect that obviously that secret variable does not leak. Well, we'll see that by means of a transient execution attack, the attacker can actually make the victim execute some other code speculatively or do some things speculatively that will actually leak the secret in an unexpected way. So how does that work? We're now going to look at the attacker code. So the first thing the attacker does is it will call the process method a number of times with valid index. So it will provide an index I that is within range of this pub array. This bounce check that is present in the victim code will always succeed, and this code will be executed. The attacker does that essentially to train the branch predictor, because what the CPU will see is for all the executions of this method, what I'm noticing is that for this particular if-then-else, it's always the then branch that is taken. So even without zooming into how prediction mechanisms for branch prediction in the CPU work, it's, I think, reasonable to assume that if the processor sees many, many instances of this branch going into the then side of the branch, that the branch predictor will, for future occasions, predict that the then branch will be taken again. Okay, and that's actually what the attacker is trying to do here. He's trying to train the branch predictor to make sure that in future calls, the predictor will take this then path rather than the else path, which does nothing. So that's the first step of the attacker. The attacker will also prime the cache. So he will make sure that all entries that can be used in the cache for array B will actually be occupied by attacker memory. Let's assume that the area of memory that competes for the same cache entries as B is called A. So the attacker will make sure that all entries of his array A are actually present in the cache, for example, by accessing each of these elements of the array A. And now everything is set to launch the attack. So now the attacker can launch the attack. And what he does is he will call now process with an out-of-bounds parameter. And so architecturally, this will do nothing, right? This size parameter here will fail this size check, and this function will actually do nothing. But unfortunately, because of speculative execution, while this process function is executing, if the CPU is running ahead here, speculatively executing future instructions, because of the fact that it had learned that for this if then else, the then branch is usually taken, it might speculatively execute this assignment even with an out-of-bounds parameter. Okay? And so we see that with an out-of-bounds parameter, pub I might actually refer to the secret. It's an out-of-bounds access to the array pub that now actually points to this number 3 here, to the secret number 3. So now 3 will be used as an index into B, and what we will see is that speculatively, the processor will already execute this code and will already load B3, right? So this will go to the cache. Now then, at some point, the processor will notice, oh, I mispredicted. We're not actually taking the then branch this time. We're taking the else branch. And all will be fine in the sense that the assignment to Y here will not happen. It will never be visible to software. But unfortunately, the microarchitectural effects, the fact that this thing is now in the cache, are not rolled back and will still be there. And this is now something that can be observed by the attacker. So what the attacker will do is, as in the cache-based side channel attack before, it will measure how long it takes to access each of the entries of this array. Most of these will be fast because they will still be in the cache, but one of them will be slow, and that's the entry that was evicted from the cache. In this case, it's the entry with index 3, so this is 0, 1, 2, 3. So from that, the attacker learns that the value in this memory location here was actually 3, and the attacker has learned the secret. And this is a really dangerous kind of attack, because if you look at the source code of this program, it seems completely impossible for this program to leak secret, because it never even accesses it. It never even touches it. It's data at rest. But because of the fact that speculatively this program might still have a buffer overflow that might access other parts of memory, the secret can still be leaked through the cache-based side channel that I talked about before. Okay, so this example is a very simple variant of Spectre. It's a Spectre variant 1 example, and there are many other variations of this kind of attack, jointly called transient execution attacks. So this class of vulnerabilities is relatively new. So while I mentioned memory management vulnerabilities and structured output generation vulnerabilities because they have been so important in the past and still are, I'm talking about this class of side channel vulnerabilities because this is really the new class of vulnerabilities that only came into public view in 2018. So Spectre and Meltdown were the first such transient execution vulnerabilities, and they were publicly disclosed early 2018. So this is a class of vulnerabilities for which we don't have a very deep understanding yet. There may be many kinds of attack techniques that we're still overlooking. We also don't yet fully understand how to defend against these attacks. So should we have countermeasures in hardware or in software or in combination? This is something that is currently being investigated by the research community. So to conclude my presentation, we have discussed three important categories of vulnerabilities that enable specific attack techniques against software. This is just a sample of what you can find in the Software Security Knowledge Area document. Actually, in this presentation, I focused a bit more on how to exploit these vulnerabilities, how to attack software using these vulnerabilities. In the document, there is more emphasis on how you protect against these vulnerabilities. So how can you prevent them or detect them, or how can you mitigate the effects of their exploitation? And I hope you will be intrigued by this seminar and will be interested now to take a look at the actual software security document from the Cybersecurity Body of Knowledge. Thank you very much for your attention.